Well, we are now at 9:30. We have taken two shots of a car going across a bridge and coming down a street. Doesn't move real fast these days.
Are you on schedule, though?
We're a little off schedule. I'd like to have been shooting by 9. So, but we're waiting for... There's the makeup intangible, the wardrobe, there are all these little intangibles, talent, and one guy's shoes won't fit him, so we had to have somebody run into town now to a Target store and buy him leather shoes.
Yes.
Look good, Eldie?
Thank you, sir.
All right, boys, we're going to have some fun now.
Oh, good.
Well, first I got to get my phone. Okay. Oh, it's my,
I've got my
car insurance.
You know, when we talked about this about a year ago, we knew we wanted to do something big for Life Touch's 70th. I had been really involved with the 60th, and the there really hasn't been anything historically produced since then. And it was such a great history. This company really does have the great American story.
3, 2, 1. Say, you wouldn't be on your way to school, would you?
Yep, sure am. Today's a big day.
And why is that, son?
The picture man's coming, and I'm getting my picture taken. Mom made me take a bath and everything.
Well, we did a 36 scene back 10 years ago. I did this picture man scene where this guy's walking along a lonely country road, or actually his car breaks down and he runs into this little boy, and the guy's fictionally Ryan Akurin, and the little boy is a fictional Dick Erickson. Of course, it's a meeting that never happened, but the picture man scene was always there, and it became almost iconic for the company over the last 10 years. So I didn't want to go back to the 30s. So we kind of talked with Chris Jones, who's been working with me writing this thing, and I wanted to do something in a later era. I've had this gas station scene bouncing around in my head forever.
Go ahead, action. Go ahead, Jim. Listen to me, Eldie. The 7th Street plan is working overtime. Reno's going gangbusters. We just hit $2 million in sales. We've got more than 100 guys in the field, but the reorder department...
A scene in the late 40s now, so Eldie and Bruce are now established. The company's been around for 13 years. It's starting to really take off. I mean, this is based on basically a true story of they used to recruit these guys any which way they can, and there is actually a famous Life Touch employee that was recruited at a gas station. I didn't know that story, by the way, until after I had conceived this story. So somebody else told me that's the way so-and-so was actually hired. I go, really?
So this is trying to depict a reality that's different from ours. Although it may have been, you know, somebody's reality sometime, this is different from ours, and you're making up the world.
Hank Schlumpka is our car guy, gentleman I met a couple weeks ago. So he's got about 38 cars. He's brought 10 over here today.
The cars, which were a blast. I mean, it just didn't matter. You could point the camera anywhere and you'd practically have a shot. And those guys out there, like, oh yeah, get in that car, go move it. So we're driving around these, you know, cars from the 20s or whatever years. I've never driven cars like that. That was fun.
What's your role? Talk about your role a little bit.
I think my role is that I'm supposed to be a storekeeper and try to peddle things off, whatever that means.
One of the fun aspects of this whole project was being able to put some Life Touch figures in and sprinkle them throughout the various scenes. And I thought that would be such a... You know, it would be a recognition factor for a lot of people, but it also, in a way, pays tribute to a lot of these people that have given so much time to this company.
Well, this morning we're at the famous Dr. Najarian's house. They've been gracious enough to lend us their attic for this pivotal scene of our generation's epic. And it's propped out pretty good. A lot of times you have to hire prop people for to put this stuff in. This wasn't a problem here.
The cameras were even more weird. Take a look. We used to haul these things around from school to school.
The Don Stoltz part. I've been working with Don for almost 20 years, and he's just a legendary actor in this market. And We've loved his voice. We've heard his voice on dozens of things over the years. And Don's been an actor since the 40s, a great actor. And it was a natural. Another thing I had bouncing in my head 8 months ago, a year ago, was this attic. I saw an attic. I saw a chest, a Hope chest or something sitting there. And I saw Don Stoltz. We didn't know where we were going to quite go with it at that point, but then. You know, it ended up developing into this exchange of the great-grandfather and his great-granddaughter, Jessie.
What if they're con men or gangsters or something?
Some people thought they were. In life, Jessie, sometimes you have to act on your hunches. And on this occasion, my hunches and my gut feel were that I should go with Bruce and Eldie. The company had heart. It was like a family.
Well, I was trying to figure out how to take a and have a spread a shot or a scene across five screens, five 20-foot wide screens, and not have the image be degraded. And what I thought of, probably because I'm just trying to do things the simplest way, is just putting five cameras next to each other and shooting the same scene with five cameras. What I didn't understand at the time, and I know very well now, is just how complex that can be, getting the same focal lengths on all the cameras, trying to align them.
No, I think that kid's gonna work out.
Yep.
He's got one problem though.
What now, Bruce?
$2 for a tank of gas. Can you believe it?
Yeah, I know. That's way too much. Oh, hey, Bruce, we gotta make up some time. Why don't you let me drive? Come on.
Producing a piece like this is an absolute, you know, there's just so many hurdles you have to jump over, and you are dealing with so many levels and so many people, and it's in a crunch time period, so you just see the calendar days flying by like minutes, and hours flying by like seconds, and the I mean, you're exhausted. There's days where you just walk in and you're just going, how the heck are you gonna get through this, or where do you start? And then at some point you do start seeing the light and you start seeing the finish line, and then you're going, okay, this, you know, we're getting there. Now we just need a little tweak here and an edit here, and you still don't know if it's going to work. You're hoping it works, and you're hoping you got a good story and you've had a great crew to work with, and, you know, good talent, and the whole works, and everything's going to combine into an effective documentary.
Cut. Well, we got the hard part done. I mean, that's we are at 6:15. You know, you kind of want to be in the 5 o'clock range there, but I'm happy.
Talk to you soon, kid.
No, I think that kid's gonna work out.
Yep.
I just got one problem, though.
What now, Bruce?
$2 for a tank of gas. Can you believe it?
Yeah, I know. That's way too much. Oh, hey, Bruce, we gotta make up some time. Why don't you let me drive? Come on. Hey, Bruce.
Yeah?
What do you think about Subak, anyway?
Subak?
Yeah.
I don't think he's gonna stick around.
Yeah? I'm gonna leave before the end of the year.
Thank you. The values and attitudes of our company founders exist to this day. This culture is intangible, yet solid. Abstract, yet well-defined.
I think we are much like a family. I think we are a very dedicated and hardworking group of people. I think that the element of ESOP adds a lot to the dimension of our culture. People are very committed to working very hard.
When I was told I only had a few months to live, I looked around my room and I saw the pictures of my children, their school pictures, their sports pictures. But this company is the one that really gave me the support and the love and the friendships, and it's kept me motivated to absolutely never say no and to fight and to win. And I'm gonna beat this brain cancer. And I am so grateful for Life Touch and who they are. I love everybody here.
Kind of the all-American story. You know, here's this, again, this honorable profession, this what we're doing for people. We're, you know, providing memories and making them feel good about themselves, their loved ones, etc. And so it's an honorable profession. And then on top of that, you know, we have this company that's been incredibly successful. And it's owned by the employees. You know, the employees, without paying anything, get to share in the fruits.
How many of you, we talked about taking care of yourself. How many of you feel like you've done that in the last 3 weeks?
Sometimes a company's culture is simply the way things are done. It is values put into action.
Life Touch realized that it needed to begin giving back to the community. Project Success is one of the two organizations at that time we had identified as not only developing children, but also creating a much stronger family unit.
I think these people had a story to tell, and I think that the photography that not only myself but all the photographers were there brought back that story so we could share it with everyone back here. And I think that every photograph that's taken has some type of story to tell.
Whether Life Touch is giving back or paying it forward, the rewards ripple throughout the company.
It's a culture of caring. People really care about each other. You can see it in the, you know, you can see it in their faces. You can see it in their relationships. I've never heard one person in our company, in any division, not totally thrilled when somebody wins an award, whether they won it or not. They give them a hug. They share in the joy.
I think the success of the company and how it grew so fast really added to the culture.
Our company founders knew that photographers deal in something which is continually vanishing. When it is gone, there is nothing on earth which can make it come back again. It must be captured as it happens.
I believe people will always want to have photographs. I still think that it's one of the most compelling things that we have today is to pick up a piece of paper and look at it.
Our photographers have always done a great job. They've always spent the time necessary to try to bring the personality of the child out. But now I think we're giving them some tools.
You know, the truth is people love portraiture. They love photography. And that is what we do. We are the world's best at delivering high quality portraiture.
You're starting to see people really, really, really caring about photography, caring about the craft that's been around for a long time.
You know that if something happens to that person's home, the one thing they're going to save is their photographs. That's a fact.
Whether it's a high school senior or a small child or a grandmother, you want to take time to discover their personality and then try and bring that out through lights and through camera angles and just something to capture that spirit while they're there.
From preschool
that first image, that smiling face, that the joy, the innocence of youth, all the way, all those stages, all those ages, we travel, we walk right alongside, we memorialize those children all the way. It's awesome.
I see you.
As we introduce wild photography, when I leave the camera, I am confident as a consumer that I'm gonna like what I see at the end.
It isn't about the props or the backgrounds or all that stuff. It's about the person.
The big wow moment for them is after they come out of the studio and they see their pictures on the selling station, and they can't believe it.
You had a birthday then.
If you can allow the photographer to become excited and allow the photographer to really enjoy what they're doing, there's this transformation that takes place that automatically goes into the customer and is reflected back.
What are you looking at?
It's all about passion. It's loving, feeling, interactive type of photography. It's not that sit down, smile, pose look.
It's much more interactive, more dynamic. They can move around, we can move around.
Yeah, look at you.
Every time we change our photography to wild photography, the customer rewards us.
Excellent. Can I look down a little bit for me?
You look at an image and you just light up, and all you can think is, wow.
Proof's in the pudding. Every place we've done it, the customers love it. We're getting increased averages and participation, and just, you know, we've really been rewarded.
How you doing? My name's Jeremy. I think I'm looking for something that'll move me, you know, that has impact. Composition definitely has a lot to do with it, subject matter. But definitely it's got to have impact.
Everything right now, everything that I've learned about photography in the technical sense, the older film style, the digital style, I've had the opportunity to learn that from LifeTouch and with working with a lot of great photographers and trainers.
A 150 years ago, we started off with glass plates, and then we went to celluloid, and then we went to film, then we went to the chips, now we're into the computers. Yeah, where is it going to go? You know, it's impossible to actually really predict that. But the one